Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the session on Deconstructing Climate Finance for Decentralized Renewable Energy, DRE, at Charcha 2021. As you might know by now, Charcha is the annual convening that brings together all stakeholders in India's development sector to chart a course for the country's sustainable development. This session is brought to you by AVPN in collaboration with the Rockefeller Foundation. I'm Kavita Tatwadi, Manager Knowledge and Member Engagement at AVPN. I'm your MC for this session, and I'm delighted to have you join us today. For those of you who do not know about AVPN, we are a network of funders and resource providers with over 600 members across 32 markets. Our mission is to move more capital towards impact. AVPN has a dedicated climate action platform which aims to unlock capital in a more targeted and effective manner into climate solutions. The platform engages with climate leaders and potential investors to find a new and impactful ways to move this capital. About the Rockefeller Foundation, the foundation has been at the forefront of accelerating access to and consumption of reliable, renewable and electricity in underserved low-income communities worldwide, empowering hundreds of millions of people while building the climate-smart energy system of the future. Recently, the Rockefeller Foundation came together with IKEA Foundation to set up a historic $1 billion initiative to catalyze investments in distributed renewable energy. In this session, AVPN brings together experts who will discuss the roadblocks and challenges for public and private finance flowing into the distributed renewable energy sector in India and how we can unpack the potential. Attendees are requested to kindly ask their questions only in the Q&A box, and the speakers will take them up at the end of the session. Please allow me to introduce you to the speakers of our session. We have with us Dipali Khanna, Managing Director of Asia Regional Office at the Rockefeller Foundation, and Shri Sinha, Director Climate India at the Children's Investment Fund Foundation. The session will be moderated by Karan Raj Chaudhary. Karan is the Advisor, SDG, and Innovative Finance at UNDP India. Over to you, Karan.
Thanks, Kavita. Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. Thank you for joining us on this Friday evening as part of Charcha 2021. We hope to have an invigorating and an engaging discussion over the next 50-55 minutes or so. And as Kavita mentioned, I'm Karan, and I'll be moderating our discussion today. And I'll be in conversation with Dipali and Shirish, two incredible leaders in the climate space, in the climate finance space. So let me just start out by perhaps introducing the topic in our session in just a little bit more detail. Deconstructing climate finance for decentralized renewable energy. It's a heavy title. We're going to try our best to keep it light, to keep it engaging. But India has, you know, set an ambitious target, as we all know, 450 gigawatt by 2030, to increase the share of renewable energy as part of our larger energy mix. And we currently currently stand at a little bit under 100 gigawatts or so at the start of this year. So there's still a long way to go. And to achieve these ambitious targets, we will require an increase also in distributed renewable energy projects, which under the right policy framework, the right regulatory conditions, offer tremendous potential for scalability. But it will also require, and it will go hand in hand also with an increase in financing. And that's what we're really trying to focus on as part of this discussion today. By some estimates, it will require an increase in DRE expenditure to the tune of 8 or 9x what it was perhaps last year. And as part of our discussion and our conversation this afternoon, we'll focus on a few things. We'll focus on how public and private financing, both from domestic and international sources, can be channeled into this sector. We will cover the financing landscape broadly, including the challenges and the opportunities. We look at the role of distributed renewable energy in terms of combating climate change. and also where we stand in terms of policy now, and where is it that we need to go in to really unlock the potential for DRE here in India, and also potentially in the region. So just to begin and to start out, you know, and I'll put this question to both Shirish and Dipali. Perhaps perhaps Shirish, you can start first. That, you know, in a country like India, where there is you know, rapid expansion of the grid, or that is really something that all of us you know, read about in the papers. And a couple of years ago, we were reading about how the last village in India was connected. You know, what is the importance of DRE from an impact perspective? What is the, you know, what is the impact on the ground from DRE? And in your context, perhaps, you know, specifically when it comes to children and youth.
Thank you, Karan. Thank you for, first of all, to you for moderating this session, and to ABPN and Rockefeller for having me as one of the panelists here. If we look at the from the energy access perspective, DRE always, the decentralized renewable energy, always had its space in the discourse in India. But I think now it's getting even more relevant as the expansion of the grid is taking place. And the technologies that are involved with DRE are becoming more cost competitive. You know, at least at the utility scale, today solar is even cheaper than other thermal energy sources of generation. And at the same time, there are different new business models that are emerging that can be deployed and can scale up DRE much faster. Now, I see this from one lens of, you know, the alleviation of energy poverty, which I'm sure even Dipali would focus upon and talk about, because that's something core to the work that they're doing. And when we look at alleviation of the energy poverty, it is about creating those sufficient choices of adequate, affordable, reliable, and at the same time, environmentally friendly solutions of energy services. Now, DRE in our approach and the way we think can, you know, address each of these attributes of that we're looking at. The other question that you asked from the perspective of youth and children, I think enabling access to reliable form of electricity is going to be so critical in terms of both empowerment as well as in terms of building the capacities for them for the future generation in terms of their access to education and other infrastructure facilities. So I think that becomes really important. Just the last point here is that when I look at the scope for DRE, I also look at it from the perspective of how the interplay happens between the unserved versus as the underserved end users. I would say to a large extent, and as what you alluded in the beginning, that we have addressed the problem of unserved, right? Through expansion of grid, through the different rural electrification programs or Saubhagya schemes, et cetera, that the government has. But what we still need to address is the people being underserved, right? Especially the reliability and availability of electricity when you really need it most. And I think that's where DRE, with multiple flexibilities of models, of whether it is grid connected or the tail end of grid or standalone or mini grids, I think all of these provide the options for the DRE route. And I think that is where electricity can start making with to transform economic activities and quality of life. So that, I think, is the still the importance and the impact that DRE can bring for the communities across, whether it is the rural areas, whether it is urban areas.
Thanks, Shirish. Dipali, anything you'd like to add to that point of, you know, now that we are moving from unserved to underserved, and also in the context of energy poverty and empowerment?
Thanks. And of course, to begin with, I'm really delighted that the Rockefeller Foundation is collaborating with the Asia Venture Philanthropy Network for this panel. And I would also like to thank the Nudge Forum for hosting this event. The topic that we are discussing today is really relevant, and given the urgency, we need to act with, as indicated by the latest governmental panel on climate change report, which I'm sure everybody's seen. Current access to reliable energy can be truly transformative for a person's life, and Shirish, you alluded to that. Although India produces surplus power, the supply remains unreliable, and certain remote regions still do not have access. So the question is, how does one increase access to power while also ensuring climate change mitigation? And for us, the answer is really decentralized renewable energy, which lies at the juncture between energy access and climate change, And we've seen that firsthand through the 500 solar mini grids in India, which we've supported. By providing reliable energy access in remote regions with unreliable or no electricity, DRE systems have empowered people to achieve their potential. I've seen it firsthand how a light bulb can help a young girl to complete her studies at night or just feel safer in her neighborhood. And that's really inspiring. Beyond the basic use of lighting, access to energy can also be transformative for livelihoods. Let me give you an example of Savitri Devi, who's a tailor by profession. Before she had access to electricity, she had to manually operate her sewing machine. When she got access to electricity through a solar power mini grid, she could use her machine with electricity, and what took her 1.5 hours to stitch now takes her only 40 minutes. With this, she makes more money in less time and has also started teaching tailoring to young girls in her village with the extra time that she has now. Besides the positive externalities on people's lives, DRE systems itself generate jobs. If we are to transition to clean energy, that would mean a certain number of lost jobs from the retiring of various coal plants. However, notably, every $10 million invested in fossil fuels creates 27 jobs, while the same $10 million invested in renewables creates 75 jobs. We estimate that the same investment into solar mini grids would create at least 150 to 200 local jobs, likely creating more jobs than the job losses it causes. So I think there are quite a few myths out there, so I wanted to debunk that. Through our work, we also know that a decentralized approach helps add more environmentally sustainable jobs into the economy and has a much larger impact in doing so than large-scale renewable energy generation. For every megawatt of installed capacity, rooftop solar creates 24.7 jobs as compared to a large-scale solar and wind plant that generates 3.5 and 1.27 jobs, respectively. The sector could also support up to 42 million jobs globally by 2050. But the number could rise far higher if we can realize the full potential of DRE projects to create local, sustainable, and highly skilled jobs. In addition, I must highlight DRE's impact on empowering women. Women spend more time doing domestic labor and taking care of children and other family members. Evidence has shown that access to energy can uplift a woman's life, making her more independent. Access to electricity through DRE can save hours of drudgery, collecting firewood, save hours of time, and improve her health by reducing indoor air pollution. Also, DRE plays an important role in involving women in the energy value chain by providing employment. Although there's no guarantee that DRE provides equal access to employment, something that we still have to work on, a significant portion of green jobs are performed by women. Around 60% of the informal workforce in the DRE sector are women. Often, though, employment, they employ their sales agents. Moreover, through our work with Smart Power India, we've seen that women perform as well as men, or probably better because of my own bias, in the energy supply businesses, despite it being a male-dominated sector. For example, in Odisha, a network of 120 women known as Bijli Didis collect bills and address consumer concerns. As a result of their efforts, an additional 8,000 customers started paying bills on time, and over 1,250 houses and 300 businesses got connected to the solar grid. Thus, by providing clean and reliable energy in places with erratic or no supply of electricity from the main grid, DRE systems help uplift the lives of people, typically with less economic opportunities. So I think we are very convinced about the impact of DRE. Back to you, Karan.
Thanks, Dipali, and thank you also for sharing, you know, some of those concrete examples and those numbers there, and the fact that DRE, that the impact is really cross-cutting, right? So the points that Shirish made around addressing everything around energy poverty, reliability of supply, you know, points you made around women empowerment, the huge difference, the 8x almost difference in terms of number of jobs per megawatt between distributed energy and larger solar installations or other grid connected installations. So there is a cross-cutting impact there. I was going through a study, I think just a couple of weeks ago, on the impact on on everything from sort of food supply and food wastage, and all of these other areas as well that are potentially connected to DRE and actually reliable energy more than anything, which is the key problem that this aims to solve. Just, you know, going with the, you know, going into the to the finance part here a bit, Shirish, perhaps, you know, some insights from you on, you know, the current landscape for public and private financing for DRE in India, and also in, you know, in terms of your experience, what have you seen are some of the roadblocks in unlocking capital at scale?
Thanks, Karan. So just to kind of give a sense of what's the level and share of DRE in the larger energy space. So early this week, India crossed 100 gigawatt of renewable energy installation. You mentioned at the beginning of the year, we're close to 100 gigawatts. We've just crossed that. Now, that's a significant milestone from where we were, you know, let's say 6-7 years back. But the share of DRE, if we add everything put together, is just roughly around 6%, you know, all the different applications of renewable energy. Now, that's very minimal, because everybody would recall that there was a target of just through solar 100 gigawatt, that 40% was 40 gigawatts supposed to come from off-grid solutions plus rooftop solar PV. So that was roughly 40% target for solar alone. So we are far away from that scale level of the role that DRE can actually space in the energy system. But we also know that if we have the favorable regulatory and policy environment, this scalability and this potential that exists can be reached and achieved, right? So, and I think that's something some of the bottlenecks that we need to overcome. Of course, there are certain implementation bottlenecks, which is also not allowing enough funding or financing to happen in this particular space. Now, there are two things to recall that, remember. One is that the most of the existing DRE, which have been enabled by the policy frameworks from central government and the state governments, they have really looked at downstream off-grid application. But what we're now seeing is emergence of different new models for DRE space, you know, especially with electric mobility and the grid-connected DRE or the solar pumps, which are grid-connected. You know, the previous panel of the charcha was actually discussing of the role of solar in agriculture water pumping. And I think there are new interesting models which are emerging, but they still require investments in terms of public subsidies to come in to drive that the space. The other challenge that our experience shows is the information asymmetry, right? So there is a lack of, although the work that Smart Power India, which Dipali has been supporting through Rockefeller Foundation has been doing, has really helped a lot to overcome some of these barriers. But at a larger scale, some of these project preparation barriers still remain. The transaction advisories are quite limited. So all these actually means that financial sector, whether it is public or private, finds DRE space still very challenging to accept. And this hasn't really changed a lot over years, actually. So I think that's where I think is the major challenge. So the capital requirement is small for the DRE projects, and that again means the risks around that becomes much more higher. So these, I feel, Karan, are some of the challenges that we still face. The recent assessment has shown that, as you were also mentioning, it's close to about, by 2024 itself, the potential for investments in DRE is around 10 times requirements. About 18 million is an estimate that one of the recent studies have actually shown. We are far away from that, right? So we are just doing about 1/10 of that potential that exists in the market. And I think that probably is where we need to focus more on how we can basically de-risk the sector further. And I think there is now enough evidence in terms of projects and the impact that these projects can show for both improving access to electricity for productive and consumptive use, but also for the climate benefits that decentralized RE can provide. So I think that makes sense, Karan, are some of the things that we see are the opportunities and the challenges at the same time.
Thanks, Shirish. No, it's a long way to go from where we are currently to where we'd like to be. And as you said, the role of the government, the role of public investment particularly in these new business models that are emerging in light of larger sort of priorities and this whole movement also around Build Back Better, as we are talking about things like sustainable transport, as we are, you know, in this post sort of COVID era, and, you know, maybe we'll have time to talk about that a little bit as well. But, you know, the important role there that and the opportunity there for DRE perhaps also needs to be highlighted, communicated more effectively to government, and the business case perhaps needs to be established more clearly and more tangibly. And perhaps, you know, Dipali, you could just touch on that as well. But, you know, what are some of the other, you know, factors that are perhaps impeding the wide scale implementation of DRE projects in India?
So currently a multitude of challenges to wide scale implementation of DRE projects, as Shirish said, ranging from political will to the financial viability of small scale projects, you know. So despite DRE systems showing enormous promise, they're often overlooked and underinvested by governments and climate funders. Only $4.5 billion is invested in DRE systems per year to provide access to energy to poor communities. This is, of course, extremely disappointing considering 2.8 billion people suffer from unreliable access to energy. So we really need to accelerate investments in DRE to reach a level of at least $17.5 billion annually over the next 10 years to cater to the underserved population. One of the major challenges and roadblocks to large-scale adoption of DRE across the world, and especially in low middle-income countries, is that the technology that powers DRE costs, it costs much more. There has been great progress technologically to bring down the price down, yet we haven't seen the benefits trickle down to LMICs. For example, many grid developers have to pay almost as much as 2.5 to 3.8 times the global average for lithium-ion batteries. We really have to streamline supply chains, remove barriers to import, and support local business to create distribution networks. We have to standardize low-cost specifications defined by developers and manufacturers that can be produced at scale. Currently, developers remain small and fragmented. Aggregation of DRE projects also would make it more attractive for investors, help secure volumes, and unlock financing needed to drive technological innovations. Another major hindrance to the adoption of DRE is that these projects are small in size and are thus unattractive to financiers and governments who are looking at much large numbers. As a result, developers are unable to unlock access to long-term financing to make these projects viable. Government policies as well are an area where much more work needs to be done. Since again, these projects are small scale, they lack access to the same government subsidies offered to consumers of central grid power systems. Due to these policies, developers stay away from such projects and remain trapped in yesterday's power paradigm, which evolves around large centralized fossil fuel plants, which are often easier to build and finance, despite the fact that these sources of power are certainly financially risky and will really doom the planet. So at the global level, we've seen an uptake in funding to support energy transition, yet many struggle to identify viable investment-ready projects. So without a platform for capital to be deployed more efficiently at scale to support the expansion of local renewable energy projects, governments are unable to achieve renewable electrification and development targets. As a result, a large proportion of emerging economies are still dependent on unreliable and polluting energy sources, with plans to establish even more. So recognizing these challenges, of course, we're establishing a global energy platform, and I can talk about that later. But as you've also seen that, you know, from 2015 to 2020, wind and solar energy generation doubled and now commands at least 1/10 of global energy generation. Yet at the same time, the use of coal only fell by 1% in real terms. So around 500 to 550 gigawatt coal power plants are planned and permitted or under construction at present. These will make climate change worse and continue to lock billions of people out of modern economy without access to a reliable energy source. So to sum it up, let me quote IEA's sustainable development scenario, the findings of which are stark. To achieve the three SDGs, 3, 7, and 13, total annual clean power investments need to exceed $1 trillion for the next 20 years. This means an annual investment in clean power generation would need to double from $300 to $600 billion per annum, something that Shirish was mentioning as well. Another $520 billion will be necessary each year to fund the transmission and distribution infrastructure. So really a transformation of this scale requires synergies of various stakeholders, but at the top is political commitment from leaders across the world. The upcoming COP26 provides an opportune moment for world leaders to really reaffirm their commitment to a just and clean recovery from the COVID-19 pandemic.
Thanks. Thanks, Dipali. Just on, you know, if I could just have a short follow-up question for you there as well. You spoke about all of these challenges that can, you know, that are really impeding wide-scale implementation of ERE here in India, but also, you know, you gave also a global perspective there. But, you know, what are the positive strands that you've seen emerge from India, or what are the, you know, what are the things that we have done right that potentially could be replicated or could influence the scale up of DRE in other countries, you know, in the region or elsewhere?
So, you know, Karan, we've seen firsthand the work that you've done in India has helped us to really expand this model to Myanmar, where we've really been looking at how can a 30 kilowatt mini grid be able to serve at least a village size of 250 households. And there again, you know, we're really focusing on reliable energy and the productive use of energy. We've also been able to invest in tools with MIT, for example, where we have the e-guide tool, where we can really be able to better predict demand for energy. So, you know, with that, it's been easy to have the conversations with the government as well and really make a case, a stronger case for DRE. So our work in India has informed our work in Myanmar, and also we are implementing and, of course, tweaking the model to the needs of sub-Saharan Africa. So I think, you know, our India work has really helped us to kind of really see how this can be expanded across geographies. And as we're learning, we also kind of really expanding our own thinking. We're also looking at now new geographies in Asia. So pretty much, you know, we're very convinced that the work that we are doing is really important. But at the same time, we have to be looking at DRE much more broadly. So looking at CNI options, as well as really looking at, you know, some of the other opportunities that are coming up. So yes, there's been a lot of learning from our India work, which is informing our global work.
Thanks, Dipali. Shirish, you know, as Dipali was talking now, we were talking, you know, there and also earlier, we perhaps seen that the work on mini grids and distributed solar, you know, which started out very much with perhaps purely a grants driven approach, even if, you know, that was intended at the start or not. And I'd worked on, I remember in my previous role as well, the fund I was working with was also looking at that space. But it was still very reliant on grant or philanthropic capital, just as a whole, from a viability perspective. And, you know, obviously, as any sector or any space needs to scale, there's only that much that we can do, or only that far we can go when it comes to philanthropic capital, certainly in a country like India, where it's really quite scarce. Public resources in India are also fairly stretched, particularly in light of the pandemic. There's limited sort of fiscal room that is perhaps available as well to the government. So where do you really see this going? Where do you see, you know, potential scope or opportunities for investors that are looking for a return in this space? Do you see certain sort of green shoots here, certain models which are perhaps more attractive than others?
Thanks, Karan. So yes, there are, and I think as Dipali was mentioning, there are several initiatives in India, and the smart power is a good example of how it has managed to build on what has happened and worked in India, and, you know, keep doing course correction as you scale up and you move into other geographies. We are seeing that, you know, similarly, the work that is happening just within India itself, how the work around the solar pump and irrigate model that was started in Maharashtra is now getting scaled up slowly and getting adopted as a model of grid connected DRE broadly, not just for solar irrigation, but also for others. So I think it's really emerging examples from India's own experience domestically is going to inform how policies are made or new investments are coming in the states. In terms of where, what could be the opportunities which we see in for the financial sector and the public and private investments to happen, we see there are three different kinds of opportunities, right? One that is around financing that will actually support the actual transaction. So these would really be the kind of projects that are needed and the instruments that are needed to actual operationalize different projects. And these would, whether it is mini grid, off grid, rooftop solar PV, I mean, all these projects do need some form of financing. And you're right that, you know, a lot of past experience in the DRE space actually has happened as a result of the grants that were made available, whether it was coming from philanthropies or it was coming from the bilateral, multilateral agencies, you know, in making this, or even the government's own subsidies, you know, which was really project specific. And we also saw the challenges with those in models, because they kind of, once the systems were installed, there were problems of them being maintained, etc. So we never had a very clear model which helped us to act as a baseline on which people could scale up. So one is actually the work that financing that can actually set up clear models of investment models for the transactions to really happen through projects. The second area of work that is really needed is around the risk mitigation mechanism. This is where I believe the subsidies that we have, and this is the smarter ways of deploying the subsidies and all the payment guarantees that can come. And this is, the, again, where the financial sector can actually play a huge role. So while we see that for the first category, it could actually be the loans from banks and others to come in, this is where multilateral mechanisms can play the role, or the government can play the role of risk mitigation mechanism. And we have seen that happen successfully in the energy efficiency space in India, or with the LED light bulb scheme or the super efficient energy efficient appliances program, where the risk mitigation mechanisms were kind of, the risks were hedged through the investments provided by multilateral development banks. And the third category of investments where, which is really needed for scaling up DRE, would be around the ecosystem readiness. This is where, you know, the capacity to prepare projects, that to be able to do the role that is really required to deal with the transactions that needs to happen. And this is a space where the philanthropy can play a role. So we see that for each of these three different types of investments that are really needed, there are different roles for different financial institutions. And I think this is, could become a model around which these three concentric circles could become the basic in which we can try and scale up financing to happen in future.
Thanks, Shirish. That was, you know, that was really quite comprehensive. And I like that three-pronged approach that you laid down. That is, you know, of course, it is the actual project or the transaction itself, but it's also what goes around it in terms of the ecosystem, and of course the public financing and other bits that perhaps need to be structured in a more, in a smarter way, or in a way that can be more catalytic for investors.
And just to add, I think the work that you are leading now in terms of the overall sustainable finance framework, unless we don't have those regulatory mechanisms in place, many of these ideas on the, you know, the different financing instruments that is needed will not succeed unless we have the basic financial infrastructure or the regulations in place or the taxonomy in place to start with.
Right. No, thanks, Shirish. And, you know, we'll want to come to you again just a little to delve a bit deeper on the policy angle as well in a bit. But Dipali, the, you know, another question that I wanted to just put to you was that, you know, India is one of the world's largest sort of emitters currently, but we are also one of the most vulnerable when it comes to climate change, with 600 million people that are at risk from, you know, floods or heat waves or wildfires. And there is a human and an economic cost to this. For this, perhaps, you know, inaction or non-responsiveness to climate change. And there has been some debate in the past around the correlation or the impact of DRE on climate. And I'm wondering if you can just, you know, share a little bit that would help create perhaps an evidence base to propel more climate finance towards this sector per se.
Thanks, Karan. So, you know, when it comes to the urgency, of course, of transitioning to clean energy, it's especially evident in our current context and more relevant than ever in light of the alarming nature of the recent IPCC report, you know, the assessment report that was just released. Despite the pandemic and reduced mobility, the level of carbon in the atmosphere has hit a historic high. Even though economies worldwide were nearly ground to a halt for over 15 months, leading to a startling drop in global greenhouse gas emissions, that did little to show the steady accumulation of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. In the case of India, it still hosts about 5% of the world's unelectrified households, and this is despite widespread dependence on fossil fuels for 80% of power generation. Across developing economies at large, 500 gigawatts of new coal plants and the pipeline, which together could emit 85 billion tons of carbon over the coming decades. In remote off-grid villages, polluting sources like diesel are used for essential tasks like milling grain, running irrigation pumps, etc. In such areas, by DRE grids, renewable energy targets could be met while also significantly reducing carbon emissions by replacing diesel generators. Through following a low carbon approach to meet SDG 7 and SDG 13, 7.2 million new connections from off-grid technologies can be delivered, avoiding 159 million tons of carbon emission over the next decade. But it would require substantial volumes of new capital in the range of at least $43 billion. So our preliminary modeling work suggests that with adequate funding, this could be a $1 trillion market by 2030. Moving beyond DRE environmental benefits, we also need to consider that it is a way to empower people by enhancing their quality of life. Most recently, COVID has taught us an important lesson on the importance of electricity for seamless functioning of life in general or business as usual while we are locked indoors. Reliable electricity empowers people like nothing else, helping them study, work, even start new businesses while staying safe. Such an uninterrupted ability to carry on these activities is essential to enable people to be competitive in their respective fields. This is especially true in light of the also greatly important social challenge of gender equality. Increased access to distributed renewables can help close the gap on women's equity, and I spoke about it earlier as well. With electricity access, there's sure to be a significant reduction in the amount of time devoted to labor-intensive cores, freeing up time for micro-enterprises and work outside of the home. So, you know, there's genuinely a very important case around everything that I'm saying from a gender equity perspective. The DRE sector is a breakthrough global opportunity as advancements in solar cells and battery technologies are likely to accelerate their adoption. This will further unlock economic opportunities for a billion people, allowing them to compete in the global economy. So as I've just evidenced, DRE is therefore a solution that has multifold environmental, productive use, and social benefits that warrant its greater financing if we are indeed committed to a greener, equitable, and empowered future. So the Rockefeller Foundation, we've really been at the forefront of efforts in DRE, and we hope that this commitment is championed by many other industry leaders and other stakeholders going forward. There's no way we can do it alone. So we're really hoping that we can have as many partners collaborate with us in this journey.
Thanks. Thanks, Dipali. Sorry, just also one note for the three of us to keep in mind to just ensure that there's only one of us perhaps that's unmuted at one point, because I think there's some issue otherwise in terms of echo or clarity. But but Shirish, just coming to you and touching on the point that that you were just starting to make on the policy angle. And to probe a little bit deeper on that, what role do you really see policy and regulations play? We've discussed that, you know, of course, it's a hugely significant, even from a subsidy perspective, a public investment perspective. You spoke about how we need to be smarter when it comes to subsidies, how we need to think about risk mitigation. But, you know, just at a high level, what is it that we really need to do from a policy and regulation lens to catalyze a lot more capital into this space?
Well, that's the most difficult one, right? So look, if we look at the success that we have seen over the last few years with the utility scale renewable growth, what has really mattered is a policy certainty that SECI becomes the buyer on behalf of the any developers that really have. And that kind of gives assurance to the investors, right, that there is a buyer. And then obviously, wherever we have seen challenge has been where the utilities have not responded to the committed power purchase agreements, or there have been some discontinuity in some of the agreed policies, right? But at least the growth that we have seen has come because the policy framework provided that certainty for investor that there is going to be a buyer for SECI on behalf will aggregate on behalf of all the locations or all the projects which are basically coming for this one. So I would say, you know, in case of DRE space, that kind of policy certainty or a stable policy environment, which incentivizes different stakeholders and for each of the different types of DRE, we would need to have a different arrangement there. So I just kind of, you know, highlight a couple of things. Let's look at the rooftop solar, which is a huge opportunity and it's hardly tapped in India. The biggest challenge has come and opposition for the rooftop solar comes from the utilities themselves, because they do see urban consumers, or if it is in urban consumers or commercial industrial consumers who could become, who are there for revenue generation going away if they start having more and more rooftop solar as part of it, right? And I think we therefore need to see policies which are addressing those concerns. So kind of a demand aggregation model, you know, which kind of brings in the rooftop solar with the grid connected rooftop solar, which will allow DISCOMs or utilities to not just have a transaction fee, but also a regular revenue flow through the monthly fee cycle of operation and maintenance. So I think right now, if it is not in hands of the DISCOM, then they're not very much interested, because it goes to the private RESCOs and private utilities to provide the rooftop solar scheme. So I think that kind of an arrangement in the rooftop, for example, a policy shift could open up and really, you know, help and ease some of the bottlenecks that we are really facing. Right? Another one which will actually grow more in future, where again DRE becomes extremely relevant and some of the projects that we will probably see now come more live, is around-the-clock solar, around-the-clock renewable energy projects, right? Now, these are the place where the technologies would also require investment in energy storage. And though energy storage is, as Dipali was also mentioning, is extremely expensive at this stage, right? And there we need kind of a capital subsidy model, which would allow the government to step in to create that favorable environment, therefore, to make distributed storage with the DRE work together, right? And just give you a last one example, and something which is much more closer to my heart and something that worked a lot on this space is on the solar agriculture pumps. And, you know, the way currently it is working, a lot of the current procurement for the scheme works through a very centralized process. And I think if the distribution utilities are allowed to have more partnerships with the installers of the solar pump and with the consumers, farmers, whether it is farmer cooperatives or directly with individual farmers, I think that could also facilitate and create a kind of a different policy environment altogether. And then there are other options. You know, in the previous session that we were just listening to, Ashwin was kind of giving example of what has worked so far in Maharashtra and the lessons that they've learned from the first phase of the solar agriculture pumps program, which has therefore helped them to refine the scheme with the state government and also now take it up to the more broader national level. So I think there are, for each of the different DRE applications, we will have to see the niche schemes and the policy incentives that might be needed to allow farmers or to allow the DRE in itself to grow. Just on the solar pumps also, you know, what the one of the very successful example often quoted is from Gujarat, where the farmers came in as form of a cooperative and started to supply surplus power into grid. It worked on a small scale, but the scaling up to a larger scale would require different types of ring fencing the entire power purchase agreements, et cetera, with the farmer cooperatives. So I think these are, for each of the different applications of DRE, we'll have to need to tweak the policies in those directions so that actually we can actually create the favorable environment that is needed. Back to you, Karan.
Thanks, Shirish. Also, just perhaps you could just touch on, you know, you were talking about taxonomies and larger frameworks. Just, you know, what impact do you see that having, or what impact do you see, given that perhaps we currently don't have that in place right now at the India level? So if you could just talk a little bit in just a minute or two, just about that as well.
Well, I think you have a better place to talk on the taxonomy work. No, I think the absence of a very clear taxonomy and the regulations which say how the investment flow should happen really disrupts the uptake of clean energy projects, for that matter. We are seeing investments come in, but I think if we have a proper taxonomy in place, that will also very much clearly say what projects should get prioritized, what should not get prioritized, right? So you get kind of go into a go, no-go list, which also makes it easier for investors to say where to invest resources in. And I think that's why we feel the work that the government has started to define the sustainable finance taxonomy is going to be so critical in the next year or so, once that draft recommendations are in place.
Thanks, Shirish. You know, we just have about 10 minutes or so. So I'm perhaps just going to try and cover a couple of things quickly. One is, you know, Dipali, perhaps if I could come to you first. You know, just at a high level, examples of partnerships between domestic and international players that have been able to effectively channel and create positive impact in India, but also not just at a piloting stage, but at scale.
Yeah, so Karan, I think for us, it's really been exciting to see how, with the work that we started off probably in 2015, where we had a few energy serving companies who were part of our program, you know, in 2019, we had Tata Power come in, and, you know, with an aspiration and ambition of doing 10,000 mini grids. They've already, in spite of the pandemic, they've been able to build about 130 mini grids already. So I think for us, you know, just kind of having a private sector player like Tata Power come into the mix has been really exciting and encouraging. And also at scale, you know, 10,000 villages is not a small number, and really trying to reach 25 million people. So I think that's something that is super exciting. At a global level, you know, you've all seen the announcement recently with IKEA Foundation, where we put in $500 million, and they also putting in $500 million, and that partnership is up and running. So we've already got $1 billion to really, you know, spearhead ending energy poverty and really being able to drive economic development at a global level is something where partners are coming forward. Besides IKEA and ourselves, we also have IFC, and we have DFC and a few others that we're talking to. So we're hoping more and more multilateral banks are going to be coming together. We really see this global platform that we're creating, which hopefully we're going to be announcing at COP26, is going to be a place where you can really aggregate the phenomenal work the different actors are doing. I mean, if you really see International Solar Alliance, which is housed in India, you see IRENA, you see SE for All, you see SIF, you see, I mean, there's just so much that's going on, but how can we really harmonize and synergize our efforts and keep learning and adapting? Because I think the challenge ahead of us, or we can say the opportunity ahead of us, is humongous. And the only way we can make it happen is by kind of collaborating and coming together. So we are seeing a lot of traction, and we are super excited about where we are currently. I think from our perspective, COP26 is really going to be an important moment where we are really going to be doing all from our end to really push the DRE agenda and really be able to make that connection with climate.
Thanks, Dipali. You know, that's, you know, those are two huge initiatives that you mentioned, the collaboration, of course, with the Tatas and you know, 10,000 mini grids, as you said, it's not a small number. It's not something that can be done overnight. And if it really does replicate, you know, it does really indicate the potential for replication and running of these systems in the country. So that's really a great initiative, and looking forward to what comes out of COP, of course, on many fronts, including this potential partnership announcement. Just on, you know, I'm just going to, because we're just coming out of the second wave here in India, I think important to just talk a little bit about the impact that perhaps COVID-19 has had when it comes to the DRE sector as well. You know, it's had an impact on on every aspect of our lives over the last year and a half. So what, you know, what are we really seeing on the ground? Are there certain lessons that perhaps we've learned in the context of DRE during the pandemic? Where do we see this going in the medium term from a demand perspective, from a cash flow perspective, a profitability perspective, all of which will have an impact as far as scalability of DRE in India is concerned as well. So I'm just going to ask you both to perhaps just reflect on that a little bit before we close. So Shirish, first to you.
Thank you, Karan. I mean, on the actual impact of the COVID on DRE projects, I'm probably I will defer to Dipali because they've been much more closer on the ground to see through the different projects that they've done. I think moving beyond, our view has been from a foundation perspective is that the post COVID recovery provides us an opportunity to look at resilient recovery. And this is where we can actually drive the clean energy transition agenda much more closer to with the government, with the state governments in particular, for actually looking at the different models of implementation. One thing that is very clear that we understand is that we need probably a very different development paradigm to happen. The reverse migration of the workforce that we saw, I have a feeling that we need to create a fairly new models of growth in different parts of the country, and especially the eastern part of the country, which will also be at the epicenter of all the energy transition that needs to happen. And therefore creating those diversification of livelihood opportunities there, where clean energy therefore can play a crucial role in creating those micro enterprises, creating those new opportunities for jobs. Because the current urban infrastructure or in large industrial town infrastructure has really showed that there is not enough capacity to safeguard interest for everyone. And therefore, there will be probably a reluctance of people to come back into the trends kind of indicate in that direction, And I think it's also a new way of development thinking that needs to happen. So I know it's a pretty woolly and winding response to your question, but that's probably the direction in which we need to look at new models of growth in emerging in different parts of the country, creating more local opportunities with group of enterprise on this ground.
Thanks, Shirish. Dipali, any reflections from you on the impact of COVID and where you see this going?
Yeah, I think, you know, of course, one of the encouraging things was that the energy that was being provided by energy serving companies, you know, the mini grids, that was taken as an essential service. So, you know, the government saw the importance of what they were doing. So that was an aha moment. At the same time, of course, we had to look at the reality of what, you know, people's ability to pay for energy. So, yes, you know, for some time there was a lean-in period where, you know, there was a voucher system which was introduced because we had to kind of really respond to what the disadvantaged communities and villages were facing. I think at the same time, you know, with all the migration that's happened, you know, and the need, as Shirish was saying, there's just so much of potential. How do we kind of start looking at the enterprise piece in a very different way? And how do we tap into the potential that energy efficient appliances can be providing? You know, because in the early days, we also learned that, you know, by energy just coming into a village, we'd assume the villages would start thriving. That isn't the case. You know, how many shops can start selling cold drinks? You know, people's ability to purchase cold drinks can't go up. You know, so you, instead of one shop, you had four shops, and you kill that one shopkeeper who could at least sell as Coca-Cola as the others couldn't, right? So, you know, how do you kind of get new enterprises? How do you really work, you know, keeping the kind of different value chains that are possible right now? I mean, the agriculture and energy value chain, looking at aspects around food processing, the cold chain possibilities, milk chilling plants. So, you know, there's just a different way of how do you really make the rural economic zones much more attractive so that people can really be able to move up the energy ladder as well as the poverty ladder is something that we've seen. And, you know, the people's aspirations are only going up. So how do we really match that? And how do we have the energy efficient appliances so that they're not guzzling more electricity or using generator backups than to run their enterprises is a challenge. I think for me also personally, like, you know, we also saw from a gender perspective, it was really important to kind of rethink how we were kind of really working with women. Were we really keeping them at the center of all our decision making, whether it was a simple thing of where the light bulb was going to be placed in the house, which if you ask the men, it was obviously going to be in a place where in the evening they could drink. And I'm sorry, Shreesh and Karan, I know men are very sensitive, but, you know, one has experienced that. And, you know, you talk to the mother and she'd say, I want to keep it where, you know, one can cook and the kids can study. They're very different imperatives which are driving the decision making. So I think more and more, even with the enterprise development, rather than just leaving it to men and seeing that, you know, women will come along, I think we really need to be working quite differently. So I think that's been a major learning as well.
Thanks, thanks, Dipali. And you know, we've just come up on time. So let me, of course, you know, thank AVPN and Rockefeller for hosting this track and the Nudge Foundation, just for this larger convening and these exciting sets of conversations that we have during Charcha, and of course both of you for such an engaging and stimulating conversation. You know, we covered a vast sort of range during the last perhaps 15 minutes or so, 55 minutes, starting out with the case for DRE, talking about energy poverty, women empowerment, talking about the jobs that can be created, talking about where DRE currently stands in the larger sort of mix and the fact that there's still a long way to go. We spoke about the exciting business models that are coming about, the fact that there is potential to catalyze investment capital here beyond just subsidies, but there is also a need at the same time to relook at the way public investments are being made in this space. To look at, as Shirish put it, to look at not just financing the transaction, but also give due consideration to risk mitigation mechanisms, to look at the fact that ecosystem readiness support, things like project preparation, advisory, diligence, all of these things that matter to commercial investors and others, that all of those needs are catered to as well. You know, Dipali, you covered the evidence base around DRE, the correlation to climate change, given that India is one of the most vulnerable in the world. We spoke a little bit about the impact of COVID. But I guess the key messages here were, you know, just in terms of how is it that we harness our collective efforts. And then as Dipali said, you know, leave it to the women, right at the end. But just the important role that DRE plays on, you know, for and the impact that DRE has on all of these aspects around women empowerment and so on are incredibly important. So looking forward to the announcements that come out of COP, looking forward to the work that we're all collectively doing in our small ways, some in larger ways, over the coming months. So with that, thank you for this exciting conversation, and I think we are ready to close this session.
Thank you, Karan.